Mightier City Expats Club is a non-profit social organisation and our speakers are volunteers. The club as such assumes no responsibility or liability for the professional reputation of or the quality of services provided by the speaker today.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I did ATK test yesterday already and it's negative, so I can push my mask down, okay? First of all, I would like to thank the Pattaya City Expat Club to give me and my team an opportunity to join the meeting and give this presentation to you. Before I start, I would like to know how many of you have high blood pressure? Whoa. Okay, I think this talk will be quite useful for you to help you control your high blood pressure. And if you have any question after the talk, I'm happy to answer all your questions, okay? So the topic that we are talking today is hypertension. Actually, hypertension means high blood pressure. As you might know that the incidence of the high blood pressure is progressively increased when we get older. Don't be surprised that if your blood pressure is more acceptable when you're quite young and when you're getting older, it gets higher. That's normal. We call the aging process. We cannot prevent it. But the thing that most important about high blood pressure is it doesn't cause any complaint or any symptom. That's why we call it silent killer. So we're going to go into more detail about high blood pressure. What is the blood pressure? Thinking about you pump the air into a tire of your car, and when you measure the pressure of the tire, it have a number. But the tire pressure, they have only one number. But for the body, when the heart contracting and pump the blood out of into the blood circulation, into your blood vessel, we have two numbers. The first one we call systolic blood pressure, and the second one we call diastolic blood pressure. I will get in more detail during the talk. What is the systolic blood pressure mean and the diastolic blood pressure mean? Normally the normal number of these two blood pressure are 120 or below, over 80 or below, okay? And the blood pressure can be controlled by many factor. The first thing is the blood property. Like if your blood too thick, it can cause high blood pressure. The second one that controls your blood pressure is your heart, because the heart is a muscle, it pumps the blood. If it pumps the blood too hard or too fast, the blood pressure getting higher. And the third one is the blood vessel itself. If your blood pressure higher, it means that sometimes your blood vessel is stiffer. So the blood pressure will be increasing when you're getting older. And the last factor that can cause high blood pressure is the we call comorbidity, or your underlying medical condition. Like in some patients who have diabetic, who have obesity, who have kidney problem, they tend to have higher blood pressure. I keep going. Okay, and the blood, first we can go into the first factor that controls your blood pressure, which is the blood property. As I told you that if your blood is too thick, sometimes it can cause high blood pressure. Such as when you eat more salty food, the salt contains sodium, you know that. When the body absorbs sodium into the blood circulation, your body have to retain more water to dilute your blood. That's why the blood pressure getting higher. And if your blood volume expand with this excess fluid in your circulation, your heart have to pump the blood harder and faster. That cause high blood pressure. Okay, and the heart is a muscle. If the muscle working too hard, it pump too fast, it put up your blood pressure. And if it have to work in this condition for quite long period of time, it can get weakening, and it can get into failing heart. We call heart failure. Or in some patients, if the blood pressure is too high, it make the plaque inside your artery rupture, and it cause heart attack. Because higher blood pressure, it create more stress to the blood vessel wall. We call the shear stress. If the shear stress is getting higher, it can rupture your plaque. That's why in some patients with uncontrolled high blood pressure, they can have higher risk of getting heart attack. Okay? And the blood vessel itself, when we're getting older, the aging process can become in a row. Okay. So it is all the factors that can control your blood pressure. Okay, I already mentioned about that. And if your blood is too thick, as I told you, like you eat too much salty food, your heart have to work harder. And the heart itself, if it have to pump the blood too hard or too fast, it can cause the problem. Okay, this is the most important factor to make high blood pressure. As you might know, when we're young, our blood vessels are soft and elastic. But when we're getting older, the aging blood vessel getting stiffer. And in some patients with high cholesterol, the cholesterol itself can deposit into the blood vessel wall and make the blood vessel stiffer and narrower. We call this process atherosclerosis, okay? And this can cause high blood pressure. And in this kind of narrowing blood vessel, it's prone to have heart attack if the blood pressure getting too high. Okay, and another risk factor is your underlying condition. Like when you're getting older, the blood pressure seems to be getting higher in the aging process because the blood vessel gets stiffer. And in some patients, they can have genetically mediated high blood pressure. They have family history of high blood pressure running in their family member. And for male, we know that female sex hormone sometimes can lower your blood pressure. So we have high incidence of high blood pressure in male or in women who postmenopause. Okay? And sedentary lifestyle, physical inactivity, lack of exercise, sometimes can push up your blood pressure. Okay? Smoking, the most important risk factor for many, many conditions. A heart attack can cause by smoking, stroke can cause by smoking, and the blood pressure, higher blood pressure can cause by smoking as well. And obesity sometimes they can cause the condition we call obstructive sleep apnea, or the patient who obese, when they sleep, their breathing interrupted during sleep, and that make the oxygen level in the blood getting too low, and during the sleep, the heart and the brain have to working. It not have adequate rest during the sleep. So it means that your heart and your brain working 24 hours continuously. That cause high blood pressure. Okay? And sometimes the patient with diabetes and high cholesterol can have high blood pressure as well. And the most important thing about high blood pressure is excessive consumption of alcohol. Because the blood pressure is the quite important risk factor for many, many diseases, how can we diagnose it? Okay? First, we have to know that high blood pressure or hypertension. From the medical point of view, it means that when your blood pressure, the systolic blood pressure, greater than 140 millimeter mercury, and diastolic blood pressure above 90. This is the definition. But we don't make diagnosis only one single blood pressure measurement. Like if you have the blood pressure done this morning and it's higher than this, we don't label that you have hypertension. We have to make sure that it's not from like you just have some argument with your wife and come to this meeting. The blood pressure is going to be high, right? So we have to keep monitor your blood pressure. Normally it takes about 2 or 3 months at least to make sure that you have definitely have high blood pressure. Normally when we going to diagnose the patient with high blood pressure, we have to be sure, because if I label you with hypertension, it will be with you forever, because when you have high blood pressure, it's not treatable, it's not reversed. It means that you will have this condition. And you have to, the best thing about making diagnosis of high blood pressure at the moment, it will do what we call home blood pressure monitoring. Like you have the blood pressure device, and you keep monitor your blood pressure at home. And if it's high, you bring that information to doctor. The doctor can tell that you have or don't have high blood pressure, okay? To measure your blood pressure, they have, as I told you, we have two numbers, the systolic blood pressure and the diastolic blood pressure. What is the systolic blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure mean? The systolic blood pressure means when your heart contracts, the heart chamber that holds the blood, we call left ventricle. When it contracts, it pumps the blood out of your heart into the blood circulation, into your blood vessel. And the height to which the blood pressure goes is called systolic blood pressure. And normal number is 120, okay? For the diastolic blood pressure, because our blood vessel is elastic, during the heartbeat, the blood vessel constrict to maintain the blood pressure elevated, so the blood pressure don't fall down to zero during the heartbeat. This number we call the diastolic blood pressure. It indicates the blood flow to your organs, okay? And the normal number is about 80 or below. To measure your blood pressure, normally, we recommend the patient to do it at home. To do it, you have to do it in correct or standard way. First, you sit down comfortably, feet on the floor, back supported, okay? And you relax and put your arm on the table, your machine on the table. And after you rest for 5 minutes, you record your blood pressure, okay? And your blood pressure, I normally recommend my patient to do 3 measurements. You discard the first one, and you evaluate the second one, the second two. And you can wait about 1 or 2 minutes apart between the reading, okay? So quite important factor when you measure your blood pressure, you have to rest 5 minutes before, and you have to choose the proper size of your blood pressure cup. I will tell you later what is the way to choose the right one. And I tell you, you measure it 3 times. You discard the first one and evaluate the next two. This is how we choose the right cup, because as you might know, some patient is big, some patient is small. We have to be sure that you have the right cup, so we can be sure that the measurement is correct. So normally, every blood pressure, there you have the thing we call index. When you lap your blood pressure cup around your arm, this index have to lie within this this area, we call the range. If it lie to this area, it means that your arm is too small. You have to use smaller cup. If it lie outside this, it means that your arm is too big. You have to buy the bigger one, okay? And cell blood pressure monitoring is quite important because it can give the doctor about what is the response of your blood pressure treatment if you are taking medication. Because some patients, they can have high blood pressure in the morning, and if you measure your blood pressure, normally I recommend the patient who is taking medication to have home blood pressure measurement 2 times, one in the morning before taking the medication, and maybe about 8 or 9 p.m. So if the blood pressure in the morning is too high, it means that you have within the high blood pressure in the early morning. So in this patient, sometimes we have to split the doses of the medication. You have to take the medication after dinner to better control your blood pressure early in the morning. This is why the blood pressure monitoring at home is quite important. And it can give you how well is your blood pressure control. I think you will be more happier if you know that your blood pressure is under control at home. So if you have blood pressure monitoring at home, it can give you that information, okay? And sometimes we have the thing we call white coat hypertension. White coat hypertension means that when you measure your blood pressure at home, it's quite okay. But when you go to the hospital, you see beautiful nursing staff or doctor, and your blood pressure jump up. But at home, it's normal. If the doctor know that you have this kind of condition, sometimes they can avoid increase your medication, because if you don't have the evidence that your blood pressure is well controlled at home, the doctor can increase the medication, and then you get very low blood pressure at home that can cause some dizziness, falling or something like that. So this is the quite important information for the doctor to know. And for the blood pressure, if you measure it at home, we have a different number. For the office blood pressure, we use 140 over 90, but at home we use 135 over 85. Okay. And the most important thing, if you have blood pressure machine at home, you have to bring it to the doctor and to make sure that it's still reliable, it's still working properly. Otherwise, your information it might not be correct. For the symptom of high blood pressure, as I mentioned earlier, that the high blood pressure can cause no complaint. That's why we call it silent killer. But if you have high blood pressure high enough, sometimes you can have a headache, dull headache. You can have dizziness, fatigue. In some patients who the blood pressure very high, you can have bleeding per nose or have blur vision. In that case, you have to go to the hospital immediately, because it means that your blood pressure is dangerous. So the blood pressure, we classify it into type. The vast majority of the patient will fall in first category we call essential or primary hypertension. It is genetically mediated hypertension that have no underlying cause. 95% of the patient with high blood pressure will be in this category. But 5% of the patient can be the high blood pressure from another disease like kidney function reducing disease, or some endocrine disease like they have too much hormone in their body that make their obese or something like that. And why we have to treat high blood pressure? Because high blood pressure is the major risk factor for many conditions. It can cause heart attack. It can cause heart failure. It can cause heart artery narrowing. It can cause stroke. It can cause bleeding in the brain. It can cause kidney failure. It can cause blindness. The major target organ that can be injured by high blood pressure. There are three major organs that can be affected from this. First one is the heart. And I tell you, if the heart have to work and working in high blood pressure condition, the heart have to adapt themselves. Sometimes the wall of the heart muscle, the wall of the heart chamber is getting thicker because it's left ventricular hypertrophy or thickening of the heart muscle. And if it's thicker, keep getting thicker and thicker, sometimes you can have we call heart failure. And sometimes that can cause heart attack. For the brain, that can cause stroke or bleeding in the brain. And for the kidney, that can make kidney function reducing and make kidney failure. And for the eye, that sometimes they can have bleeding in the eye and cause blindness. So apart from all those three major organs, they can have, they can cause erectile dysfunction, they can cause dementia. So because the blood pressure is, we call it a major risk factor for all those conditions, and it can be independent of another risk factor. So it's very important to know that you have high blood pressure at early stage, so we can have some intervention to prevent you to getting more injury to the major organ, like the heart, like the brain, like the bone, like the heart, like the brain, like the kidney. The blood pressure is still the major disease that still have higher incidence worldwide. As we know that the prevalence of the high blood pressure is getting higher and higher. It will approach 1 billion patients with high blood pressure. And the important thing about high blood pressure is about 50% of the patients with high blood pressure, they don't know that they have high blood pressure, because as I told you, the high blood pressure cannot cause any, can cause no complaint. And about 20% of the patients, even though they know that they have high blood pressure and they take medication, the patient who have their blood pressure under control is only 20%. This slide shows you that the incidence of the high blood pressure is increasing, especially in developing countries. And if we compare to So because I think in developing countries like Thailand, our lifestyle is changing. Many people eat more salt and have less exercise, and they get obese. That's why the incidence of high blood pressure increasing. Okay, go ahead. Compared to another risk factor, like diabetic smoking, hypertension is the number one global risk factor for global mortality. It will approaching nearly 10 million deaths each year. This is quite important slide. It shows us about the higher the blood pressure, the higher mortality you will get. Compared to the patient, the blood pressure normal, like I told you, less than 120 over 80. If your blood pressure going up to like 130, 135 over 85, or it increased 25 millimeter of systolic blood pressure and 10 millimeter of diastolic blood pressure, your mortality, the risk of mortality, that it double from 1% to 2%. And it it keep doubling. If your blood pressure getting higher, the higher is the worse. Okay. But the good thing is, even though your blood pressure is high, and we can manage to reduce your blood pressure even very very small number, like 2 millimeter of mercury, it can extrapolate to about 7% reduction of the risk of having heart attack, 10% risk reduction of having stroke. So it means that the lower the blood pressure is better. And how to treat it? The goal of treating the patient with high blood pressure, we would like to prevent the damages happening to major organs, especially the heart and the kidney, okay? And the aim to make your blood pressure lower than 140 over 90. And in some patients, like the patient with diabetic and chronic kidney disease, we would like even lower number to about less than 130 over 80. So we start with no medication first. If you have high blood pressure, like 140 plus, something like that, you don't need medication. If you don't have heart problem, you don't have another problem, we can start the first step to avoid the harmful habit. Like if you have sedentary lifestyle, you have to be more active. If you smoke, you have to stop smoking. If you drink a lot of alcohol, you have to drink in moderation, okay? The second step is to reduce salt and high fat diet. And then if you're obese, you lose weight, okay? Regular exercise. And the last one, if you can do, it's quite difficult. You should adopt the diet that we call DASH diet. DASH, it comes from dietary approaches to stop hypertension. It's the name of the study. It is a study to compare the patient with this kind of diet and conventional diet. They can see that the patient who adopt that diet, they have tend to be lower their blood pressure. Our dietitian outside can give you in more detail about what is this diet. But I can tell you that diet, you have to eat less salt, sugar, saturated fat, and processed meat. You can remember 4S. S, salt, sugar, saturated salt, and sausage. Okay? And eat more fruit, vegetable, low-fat dairy product, and more whole grain. That's the key, okay? Lose weight is the most important thing if you obey, because it equals one medication. It can lower your blood pressure quite a lot, and you have to keep yourself more active, okay? Reduce salt intake, stop smoking, and reduce consumption of fatty food, eat more fruit, vegetable, drink alcohol in moderation. If you have sleep apnea, and they tell you, the patient stop breathing during the night, you have to be treated, okay? And if you have stress, you have to deal with it. It's quite easy to give this instruction, but difficult for you to follow, but this is the key, okay? Because lifestyle modification is quite important as taking medication, because we know from the study that if you reduce your weight, like 10 kilograms, you can lower your blood pressure 5 to 20 millimeter. And I told you, even though small reduction of the blood pressure it translates to a lot of risk reduction for heart attack, for stroke, okay? If you adopt DASH diet, it can lower your blood pressure about 10 millimeter. If you reduce eating salty food, it even lower your blood pressure. Getting more physical activity and drink alcohol in moderation can help you reduce your blood pressure as well. Drink alcohol in moderation, we mean that for the women, not more than one standard drink, and for male, it not more than two standard drinks. It's very difficult to follow this instruction, and I show you on this slide, this is the standard drink. One standard drink mean one can of beer, about 20, maybe 155 ml of red wine, or 45 ml of whiskey, okay? For the diet, we still believe in balanced diet, okay? Balanced means you have to eat variety of food in the food group, and you have to manage your portion size. You eat more fruit, vegetable, as I told you. For the salt, if you have high blood pressure, you should not eat more than 1 teaspoon of salt a day, okay? The easy way to manage your food is like you have a page, and you divide it in four quarter, and you fill in the half of the plate with the vegetable, and another quarter with the starchy vegetable, and another one with the lean meat, white meat, poultry or fish, and eat more fruit and vegetable. And if you have to drink milk, should be low fat or no fat milk. But for the fat, you should avoid using saturated fat. Saturated fat normally come from animal fat or some palm oil, coconut oil. If you have to eat dairy product or drink milk, you should use the no fat or low fat version. For unsaturated fat, it's good for the body, but eat it in moderation, okay? Unsaturated fat normally can come from avocado, olive oil, some nut, okay? And try not to eat trans fat. Normally trans fat, it can come from all bakery products, like cookie, cracker, something like that. And eat more heart healthy fish, okay? Tuna, salmon, herring, something like that. For the exercise, you should exercise at least 3 to 5 days a week. If you can manage it, you can start with 30 minutes a day up to 50 minutes a day. And in total should be at least 150 minutes a day. And during the exercise that we recommend should be we call aerobic or cardio exercise. And during the day you should do weight training, okay? If you can do all this exercise, it can lower your blood pressure about 5 millimeters. And if you did medication, I will give you some more information about the common medication that the doctor can give to you. Normally we have 5 main group of medication. The first one we call diuretic, a water pill. The name of the medication in this group will be ended with I, like furosemide, indapamide. You can see the end of the name of the medication, and you know what this medication belongs to, what is the property of this medication. Water tablet, it gets rid of excess salt and water from your body, and that can lower your blood pressure. The second group is called beta blocker. It will end that with the name oral, like metoprolol, bisoprolol, something like that. Beta blocker working by slow your heart contract to slow your heart beating and reduce the contraction of your heart. That can lower your blood pressure. The third one is we call ACE inhibitor. It will end with pill. Like enalapril, tenapril, lamipril, or something like that. it working by it inhibits one of the enzyme called angiotensin converting enzyme, because if we inhibit this enzyme, it can reduce the production of the substance in your body called angiotensin. The angiotensin can cause blood vessel constriction, especially in the kidney. Another group is we call angiotensin 2 receptor blocker. The name will end with Artan, right? Telmisartan, valsartan, or something like that. It's the same, it blocking the action of the angiotensin at that receptor that can reduce the blood vessel constriction. And the last one we call calcium channel blocker. The name of it will end with the IP, like manidipine, amlodipine, something like that. It prevents the calcium entering the smooth muscle cell in your heart, in your blood vessel, and help relax your blood vessel. And if you're taking your blood pressure, because the new medication at the moment, it's working quite okay, at it's a long-acting medication. You can take once daily. And it have to be, it's quite important that you should have your blood pressure at the same time of the day. Normally the pharmacist will label it taking after breakfast, but sometimes you don't have a breakfast at the same time. That's quite important for the doctor to know, because the blood pressure action, the blood pressure medication, it works 24 hours. If you have not regular meal, it means that you will have the gap that the medication not enough in your blood circulation. So I always recommend to my patient that take it first thing in the morning, maybe half an hour after you wake up, and take it at the same time. And if your blood pressure seem to be high in the morning, you can split the dose to take it at night. And if you miss your blood pressure medication, when you remember, you can take it. Okay, that's all. And do you have any question? So as I told you, that the lower the better, but sometimes we cannot lower the blood pressure to that level, because in some patients, like the patient with the heart artery narrowing, we cannot lower the blood pressure to that level. And sometimes to make the blood pressure too low in some patients, they have a side effect, like they have dizziness, they have fatigue. That from the slide that I show you, it is from the epidemiological study, compare the blood pressure in person that at that number to the one that higher. I understand your point, but sometimes we have to balance about the risk and benefit of getting the blood pressure to that level.
Doctor.
Hello, a lovely talk. I do have a sweet tooth, so I have to be very careful, but you frightened me when I looked on the what you can't eat and what. Can you please tell me what snake cakes are? What snake cakes? It's doesn't mean anything to me. I know what a snake is, but snake cakes?
Oh, you mean a cake? Actually, I'm not sure. In Thailand, we try to avoid, we prohibit using trans fat in the bakery industry. I think start few years ago. But at the moment, I'm not sure in the market that still have that trans fat in the market or not. If you can be sure that the bakery that have no trans fat inside, it should be okay. But to eat more that dairy product, you have to keep an eye on your cholesterol level if you have underlying condition.
What is the situation if your systolic is high but your diastolic is normal?
Because that isolated systolic hypertension. Normally, when you're getting older, your blood pressure, your blood vessel gets stiffer, and your diastolic blood pressure tend to be lower. In some patients, the blood pressure, the systolic blood pressure can be above 150, and the diastolic blood pressure still 70. So in that case, it's quite difficult to treat. We have to lower your blood pressure to below 140, but we have to keep an eye on your diastolic blood pressure as well, because diastolic blood pressure means the blood flow going to your organ, especially the heart. If it's too low, it's not good. In that case, I think your doctor will be adjust your medication. Like they might need some kind of medication to only reduce your systolic blood pressure, but not lower your diastolic blood pressure.
Doctor?
Yeah. Hi, doctor. I'm just wondering about the exercise part of it. I'm on my blood pressure is about 140 or 145 over 85 most of the time. So I'm trying to do a lot of exercise, and I probably do 90 minutes of hard walking 4 days a week, and probably do about 10 laps at the pool 5 or 6 nights a week. Can you over exercise at all? Would you do any harm to your heart by exercising too much?
If you exercise in that at that level and it doesn't cause any problem, I think you should keep doing that.
Keep going.
Yes, but I always tell my patient it's quite easy, because now we have smartwatch, right? When you exercise, you can monitor your heart beating. If the heart beating not going too high, like in your age, maybe 140, 150 is okay. And we know that if the blood your exercise at the we call heart rate zone 2, it allow about 60 to 70% of your predicted maximum heart rate. That's good, like 120, 130, something like that. You can exercise in this level for longer period of time, and that's good. We call that fat burn exercise. If you're obese, it can reduce your weight. But if you have smartwatch exercise, you can see if it like speed limit. When you're driving too fast, it's more dangerous. It's the same. If you exercise too hard, it's not good for your heart, for your blood vessel. Mm. Okay.
As long as it doesn't get too high.
Yes.
Good morning, doctor. Thank you very much.
Good morning.
For coming. What would be the normal beta blocker size of pill or strength of pill and ACE inhibitor strength of pill for a blood pressure of 160 over 90?
You mean that if you're taking beta blocker and
ACE inhibitor and someone 160 over 90?
Oh, it didn't.
What would be the normal dose?
Oh, we have different beta blocker, and different beta blocker have their maximum doses. For your case, I think 160 is unacceptable. Your blood pressure need to be better controlled. What kind of beta blocker are you taking at the moment?
UK beta blocker, the enalapril and amlopidine.
amlodipine. Amlodipine, the maximum normally we not go above 10 milligrams. Yes.
Doctor, look, fantastic talk. I don't think it could have been any clearer than it was. Thank you so much. By the way, I have a question for the audience. Who here started to think, maybe I'll get an at-home blood pressure test kit on the basis of this talk? Very smart people, right? If you've got any blood pressure things, have a look on Lasada. I'm sure they've got something. By the way, if you ask a question during Q&A, you get a voucher for some free tests at Bangkok Pattaya Hospital for an EKG and an ABI. There's Tanya. We all love Tanya. And the doctor's going to tell us what an ABI is. What's an ABI?
ABI is the short name for ankle breaker index. Normally, we measure your blood pressure, both of your arm, your leg, and we compare it at the index. It can give us the information about your blood circulation to your lower extremity, to your leg. If you have some abnormal number, it means that you have like maybe obstruction in your blood vessel to your leg. That can give me more information about what we call vascular health. It can tell me that how is your vascular is working at the moment. You get stiff blood vessel stiffness or something like that or not.
Excellent talk, doctor. Question with regard to chronic kidney disease. I noticed that you had a lower blood pressure then. How much significance does that play in, and should one be particularly concerned about making sure that their blood pressure is below that, either 130 or 135, and over 85, I believe?
Actually, when we lower the blood pressure, and I answer your question, we got the thing we call J curve. Okay, the J letter is like this. If you lower the blood pressure from higher level, you reduce the risk of having heart attack, having stroke. But it have the bottom, and if you lower is too low, the mortality or the risk of having heart attack or bad organ damage is increasing. That's why we don't lower your blood pressure too low. To answer your question, normally we don't want your blood pressure to be lower than 110 over 70. Okay? Because that means that sometimes the perfusion or the blood circulation to your kidney, to your heart, is impaired. Especially if you have heart artery narrowing, your blood supply to the heart, it depends on the lower number, which is the diastolic blood pressure. If that number is too low, sometimes it's not good. That's why, answer your question, we have to balance the risk and benefit of lower your blood pressure.
Hey, doctor.
Yes?
I have white coat syndrome.
Oh.
Yes, and I see a white coat or one of your nurses goes yes. through the roof. Every time I go to BP hospital, which is quite often because I have a kidney stone problem, I've been driving to the hospital. I go up and I sit down, and about 1 minute, 2 minutes later, your staff are asking me to have my blood pressure done. And I said, yeah, okay, I've just been driving a car, and they don't seem to listen. And then I tell them I have a white coat syndrome, and they still ignore it. And then my blood pressure is about 160 over 85, 90. And they're saying, oh, you have high blood pressure. What's the point? Why don't the staff wait at least 10 minutes and let your blood pressure drop down?
Yeah, yes, I agree with you. For my patient, I always measure the blood pressure by myself again in my room, because I know that it can be white coat high blood pressure and it give me wrong information. I know your point. We always keep telling them to do like that, because we know that we have to let the patient rest for 5 minutes at least. And if it's high, we have to remeasure the blood pressure. But for white coat hypertension, if you have the information about your home blood pressure, you give that to the doctor, that will give a lot of useful information to them to manage your blood pressure.
Hello, doctor.
Yep.
If you take the high blood pressure medicine, how much... If you take the high blood pressure medicine, for example, HCT, how much would you expect that to drop your blood pressure? And how long does it take to work? One day, 1 week, 1 month?
So normally the blood pressure start reducing your blood pressure, maybe they take 3 or 4 days. And they get stabilized of the effect, it take about 2 weeks. Okay. Normally, when we give, we adjust the blood pressure doses, or we give the blood pressure medication to the patient for the first time, we let them come back to the clinic 2 weeks, because we know that it will be stable, and we know that the medication working at their full action.